portrayal of Japan's capital in Ghostwire Tokyo might be my favorite depiction of a real-life city in any game ever, which is strange considering it's set in the midst of an apocalyptic event where 99% of the citizens have vanished in a rapture-like event. Their shoes, clothes, and shopping bags lay on the exact same spot of their departure. But the bright lights, busy signage, and storefront jingles of Tokyo remain, because the event occurred so suddenly that nobody had time to turn them off. It kind of feels like wandering around a theme park after it closes, where all the guests have left, but the lights and sounds are still going. While games like Watch Dogs have admirably strived to capture the entire breadth of a place like San Francisco or London in their interactive playgrounds, Ghostwire favors depth instead, making every street in Tokyo feel like it's bursting with life, despite there being pretty much nobody alive. Tango Gameworks has made a truly special piece of virtual tourism, and it has me longing to visit the city once again. I love that Ghostwire Tokyo never railroads you to your next objective, instead letting you take your time and soak in the sights. It's always clear where you have to go next to advance the story, but you're encouraged to wander off the beaten path. As much as I've been digging the core mystery surrounding the protagonist Sakito, his spirit pal Keke, and the malevolent Hanya, it's the moments where I've taken the time to meander around Ghostwire's densely packed depiction of Tokyo that have really stuck with me. Bumming around Tokyo in Ghostwire reminds me of the urban exploration contained in the free nights I had throughout Persona 5 Royal, but with the incredible density of the Yakuza games. Convenience stores manned by adorable kitten yokai beckon you to come in with their catchy jingles. Inside, you can buy all manner of stat-boosting snacks, from takoyaki to boba tea. Shinto shrines tucked away in the middle of bustling neighborhoods convey a small pocket of serenity amidst the noise of a megalopolis, while also providing upgrades to your mystical combat abilities. There are narrow alleys lined with food stands and shops and multi-layered malls that allow you to reach the city's rooftops. The subterranean depths of Shibuya Station let you get completely lost, which is pretty much how everybody's first trip to Shibuya Station goes. I spent so many hours in Ghostwire Tokyo exploring every nook and cranny of the city. I loved stumbling upon a new neighborhood or finding a wandering spirit and helping them complete their unfinished business so they could move on to whatever comes next.
Thank you. Now I can finally pass on.
Many of the kami you come across in town are drawn directly from Japanese mythology, meaning that anybody who's put time into these Shin Megami Tensei or Persona games is going to find familiar creatures like Kappa, Tengu, Kodama, and Makami. As I began unlocking more of the map by cleansing various torii gates scattered across the city, more neighborhoods became safe to explore. Well, safe is a relative term. There's still the occasional mob of ghouls roaming around, but these are easy to avoid if you want to, and pretty fun to fight if you don't. And again, while I dug the locomotion of the main story, it was discovering which new neighborhoods I'd see next that acted as the carrot at the end of my proverbial stick. I've been fortunate enough to be able to visit Japan on a bunch of occasions for various work trips. I have fond memories of spending early mornings at the Tsukiji Fish Market and late nights at the microbar mecca of Shinjuku's Golden Guy. Of all the places in the world I've missed during the past two travel-free years, Tokyo sits high atop that list. And while I've used video games as a means of virtual tourism during that time, nothing has come as close to the real thing as Ghostwire Tokyo, which is one of the highest compliments I could ever give it.